In my heart, Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Oh, can you feel it? It's the real gospel song.
Father's Day to all dads out there. This is a very special, really, time that we set aside as Americans just to acknowledge you guys and what you mean to your family. And especially today, we think of the blessings of a Christian dad. That's a double blessing right there. So happy Father's Day, dads. May you have a great day today. I just have a couple of announcements. Next Sunday is our voters meeting after this service, election of officers, board members, and to consider a budget, fiscal budget for July 1 through June 30th. So that's this next Sunday. Then the big Sunday is July 10th, ordination and installation of Eric Larson. That's a huge, huge day. It's at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and I hope you will try to be here. I know Rick Zorko is trying to find folks that are willing to sing in a choral selection for that day. So if you contact the church office, I think he's going to see if any of you guys could. So we just need voices because, ordination, it's sort of a once-in-a-lifetime thing. So it was a very special thing. And the other thing I just wanted to be sure and mention is the video study, The Chosen, has begun, and it's Sunday mornings before this service over in the education wing. So if you want a summer Bible study, a video, The Chosen is very popular. It gives a view of what the disciples must have thought as they were a part of the early Christian community. And it's fascinating. So I hope that you'll take time to consider that. I think we're ready for the call to worship. Please rise, everybody. Eric will lead us.
We make our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord is my strength and my shield. And my heart exults.
With my song, I give thanks to
you. Come, let us worship the Lord. Please be seated as we sing our song, My Jesus.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all its stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
He makes a way when there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is true. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
About me, let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh,
he takes away when there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is good. The good news is I know that he will for you. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
To rise as we confess our sins and receive our Lord's good forgiveness. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? If God were to mark our iniquities and sins, we would be left without hope. Since the time of the first Adam and Eve, we are by nature sinful and unclean. But our loving Lord does not leave us without hope. He He has given us redemption through his Son. With this confidence, we seek our Heavenly Father and his grace for the sake of Jesus Christ. Mighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption. As a servant of Christ, I assure you that he has fully forgiven you your sins through his life, death, and resurrection. Let us therefore serve him with boldness. Amen. Thanks be to God. We continue with our psalm, Psalm 3. O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me. I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, your Son, Jesus, triumphed over Satan and freed us from bondage to sin. Help us to stand firm against every assault of the devil and enable us always to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I want to invite the children up for a message delivered by Pastor Werling. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Hi, boys and girls. All right. We'll get all situated here. There we go. Well, so this is Father's Day, and I want us to just think about some things about Dad that is pretty neat or special or that you really like. So let's just talk about it. What are some things about a dad that's pretty special, pretty neat? Yeah. He's the best dad in the world. That covers all the bases and a few more. Okay, I love that. That's cool. Oh, man, what a lucky dad you got. Okay, how about some other things that we think about Dad that is kind of neat that he does with us, for us? What would you say? So your dad lets you go to more places. Is that right? Yeah, that's awesome. It's fun to go with him, isn't it? Yeah. What would you say? He helps you to build things. Is that right? Yeah, that right? Build stuff. Yeah, like Legos or stuff like that or different things. What were you going to say, sweetie? About your dad, anything. Best thing. He lets you see the weather. Yeah. That, you know, meteorologist, that's a big, a tough word. You know, all of that stuff sometimes seems to be highly secret. But you get an insight into it, right? Awesome. What a dad you got. That's great. Yeah, he won't just tell me. I got to call him up to get the answers. What else about our dads is pretty cool? Yeah.
He buys me a lot of baseball cards.
He buys you lots of baseball cards. Oh, that's good. I can appreciate that. What would you say?
He takes us to watch sports.
Takes you to watch sports, and that's fun. You know, when you think about what your dad does, there's a lot of stuff. So I was thinking about my dad, okay? He's in heaven. But I on Father's Day... Yeah, everybody thinks about their dad. Even older people, your dad thinks about his dad. So one of the things that comes to mind as I think about my dad was when I was little, I could ask Dad if he wasn't real busy at home. Let's go play catch. We call it play catch, okay? Should we play catch? And a lot of times Dad'd say, yeah. So we'd go outside and play catch. Any of you do that with your dad? That's fun, right? So that comes to my mind. Another thing, okay, is I brought this. What is that? Yeah, so how do you think that makes me think about my dad? Yeah, so when I was little, I got to carry Dad's golf clubs. I was real little because I couldn't golf yet. I mean, I wasn't good enough yet. But I just asked Dad if I could carry his clubs, and it was fun to do. So we'd go to different places, the Hayes Golf Course and different places like that. And that was fun because after we played, we'd always get ice-cold Pepsi out of an old machine where there was crushed ice at the very top of the neck. Those of you who are old know what I'm talking about. And I always looked forward to that. But then when I got older, then I could play golf with him and enjoy it. I always thought it was really cool when I could outdrive him, hit the longer one. But he always won the game, so he was good. So that reminds me of Dad, and I have good memories about that. And then I have this. I don't know if you can even, it's a little piece of paper. It's an old one. Can anybody read what that is? What does it say out loud? It's a permit to hunt. That's a hunting license. So when I was young, Dad would take me hunting. And first of all, with Grandpa and Dad, and I was too little to shoot a gun, but I couldn't wait to pick up after the shotgun shells were ejected out of the, I would go and pick up those shotgun shells and smell them. I don't know why. I think that warped my mind for the rest of my life. But there was something about that. And I got a feeling some of you others did that too. And then I got old enough to shoot a gun because Dad showed me how to do that. And he bought my first gun, which was a 20-gauge Ithaca Model 37 pump. So and then we'd go out hunting together. When I was in high school and junior high, late afternoons, go out for an hour and hunt with Dad. Oh, man, I wish I had those days back again. So that reminds me of Dad. Yeah? And I have another thing. I don't want to get too involved here, but here's another thing. This is a little notebook that's real old, and it's got the signatures, autographs of people like Maury Wills, Sandy Koufax, Don Drysdale, Leo DeRocher, I could go on and on. These were the Los Angeles Dodgers, my favorite team, when I was about 11 years old, okay? And so here's the deal. My dad had to have a medical procedure done in St. Louis. His favorite team was the St. Louis Cardinals. The team that was coming to St. Louis to play the Cardinals was the Dodgers at the time of his appointment. So we drove from Western Kansas all the way to St. Louis, and we stayed in a place called the Chase Park Plaza Hotel where my Los Angeles Dodgers were staying. And so I got to go around in the hotel, and get their autographs of 1964. Now, Dad knew that was going to happen, but he didn't tell us when we left Hill City. So I have special memories of my dad. But one of the things that I really liked about Dad was, here, you know what that is? That's not a Bible. That's the old Lutheran hymnal, TLH, the old one, okay? And Dad would sing songs out of it when we'd all go to church together. That meant a lot. And so I can still see Dad singing those songs. He never sang loud, but he'd sing. And the neat thing about that, I knew that my dad was a Christian, and that meant a lot to me. That your mom and your dad are Christian is a very, very special thing. So we have a lot to be thankful for, don't we? Yeah, yeah. And so I just want to have a prayer for you on Father's Day. I want to pray for you, okay? Oh, Father in heaven, you are the Father of us all. And you watch over us. You've given us dads. You've given us grandpas. Some are in heaven already now. But we know, Father, that because of Jesus, all of us together will be in heaven someday. But until then, there's lots of things to do with mom, with dad, with brother, sister, grandma, grandpa, our loved ones, but especially for you and for all the blessings you have given us. We thank you for each day of life. Bless these kids always in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so here, I'll let you feast on those. Okay. Thanks for coming up. Have a great day. And watch your step as you go down, okay? We don't want you to fall. You got it? Okay, we're going to get there. All right. So we turn to God's word today. We'll find out. Eric will read them if we don't. Is Nancy Turpin, I think, is scheduled. But she was in the other service, so we got Eric. Thank you, Eric.
Our Old Testament lesson from today comes to us from Isaiah chapter 65, starting at verse 1. I was ready to be sought by those who did not ask for me. I was ready to be found by those who did not seek me. I said, here I am, here I am, to a nation that was not called by my name. I spread out my hands all the day to a rebellious people who walk in a way that is not good, following their own devices, a people who provoke me to my face continually, sacrificing in gardens and making offerings on bricks, who sit in tombs and spend the night in secret places, who eat pig's flesh and broth of tainted meat is in their vessels, who say, keep to yourself, do not come near me, for I am too holy for you. These are a smoke in my nostrils, a fire that burns all the day. Behold, it is written before me, I will not keep silent, but I will repay. I will indeed repay into their lap both your iniquities and your father's. Iniquities together, says the Lord, because they made offerings on mountains and insulted me on the hills. I will measure into their lap payment for their former deeds. Thus says the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and they say, do not destroy it, for there is a blessing in it. So I will do for my servant's sake, and not destroy them all. I will bring forth offspring from Jacob, and from Judah, possessors of my mountains. My chosen shall possess it, and my servants shall dwell there. This is the word of the Lord. The second lesson is from Galatians chapter 3, starting at verse 23. Now, before faith came, we were held captives under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, and we are no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you were baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. I mean that the heir, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything. But he is under guardians and managers until the date set by his father. In the same way, we also, when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law so that we might receive adoptions as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father, so you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise and hear our gospel according to St. Luke, the 8th chapter. Then they sailed to the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee. When Jesus had stepped out on land, there met him a man from the city who had demons. For a long time he had worn no clothes, and he had not lived in a house, but among the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him and said with a loud voice, What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me. For he had commanded the unclean spirits to come out of the man. For many a time it had seized him. He was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles. But he would break the bonds and be driven by the demon into the desert. Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Legion," for many demons had entered him. And they begged him not to command them to depart into the abyss. Now a large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the pigs. The herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and drowned. When the herdsmen saw what had happened, they fled and told it in the city and in the country. Then people went out to see what had happened, and they came to Jesus and found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. And those who had seen it told them how the demon-possessed man had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding country of the Gerasenes asked him to depart from him, for they were seized with great fear. So we got into the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." And he went away, proclaiming throughout the whole city how much Jesus had done for him. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please continue standing as we say together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated as we sing our next song, Word of God Speak.
Let me stay right.
Thank you, praise band. As we gather together today, let us implore God, who does speak to us in his word. Lord, you do come to speak to us, and we ask that you would open up our minds to greater understanding and our hearts to greater faith as we trust in your Son, Jesus Christ, as our Savior, the one who came to free us from our sins and our bondage to Satan and all evil, and has freed us to life with you and life forever with you. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, my Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. As we look at our gospel text today, that frightening creature of a man, if you want to call him a man, had everyone's concern in that region. He was demon-possessed, seemingly crazed. He was out of his mind. He had been away from home for a long, long time. We don't know if he was a son of parents who were still living in that home, or whether he was a father of children still living in that home. But he had been gone a long, long time. Whether they knew where he was, we don't know. If they did know where he was, they had to have been full of shame and sadness and embarrassment. For this crazed man, so full of demons, lived out among the tombs, along a hillside where there were holes, where graves, where dead people were buried. And he lived out among those tombs, not at home with his family. He lived away from them. The Bible tells us that his possession was such that he had this enormous strength. People tried to capture him because he was scaring everybody, but they couldn't. Even the chains that they put on him, he would break. He had that much power induced by the devil. The devil has power. And as you look at this guy, you just wonder, how did he get that way? Where was the foothold? What did he do? Somewhere along the line, in some way, we're not told, the devil entered his life. And perhaps by gradual increments, the devils continued to indwell to the point where he was a bizarre, freakish, evil person. And he left home, and he lived among the tombs. Sometimes when we think of demon possession, we're liable to have a misunderstanding that demon possession back then was just really psychological issues, but they couldn't quite deal with psychological issues, so they just said, they're demon possessed. That's not true. Demon possession was an actual phenomenon that happened to certain individuals whereby Jesus quite often would drive them out. Devils would be driven out over against diseases and all kinds of situations like that, whether it was leprosy or whether it was some kind of illness of a fever or an illness by which a person was not able to function the way he could. Quite often those were solved medically, and Jesus healed many of those people, but didn't cast out demons. This man was demon-possessed. And so I was just thinking about this guy's family, especially on Father's Day. So this gospel text came up, and I thought, this speaks to fathers. It sure does. This is a day when this man received wonderful, wonderful freedom from his possession, from his demon possession. This was a day when evil met its match. when the devil finally had to say, I give, Jesus is stronger. There is also this notion among many, it's wrong, and it's this, that on an equal level, there is the devil and God. They are equal in power. That's not true at all, as we'll see in this remarkable story. God is stronger than all evil, and it's important for us to always remember that so that we always have hope in the face of it. Well, on this day, it was morning. Jesus and his disciples had been on the boat all night in the Sea of Galilee, and a remarkable miracle had happened then, as recorded in the previous chapter, when a storm came up in the middle of the night and the boat about capsized. The disciples were scared to death, and Jesus simply said, be still. The waves died down, and so did the wind. The disciples wondered, who is this? Still struggling to understand this Son of Godness of Jesus of Nazareth. And as they were thinking about that, they put the boat on the shore of the Gadarenes or Gerasenes, either way. Both of those terms are used to describe it. It was on the other side of the Sea of Galilee in unclean territory that was forbidden for Jews to enter because the folks living there were not Jews. They were Gentiles. Gentiles were considered unclean. And so when they arrived there, I'm sure the disciples thought, what are we doing here? And then about that time, here comes this crazed, wild man, demon-possessed, to confront them. And the text today says, when he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell down before him and said with a loud voice, what have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me. Now, we need to be clear here. This wasn't the man in good conscience speaking this. This was the devil or demon speaking through the man in these words. The devil knew who Jesus was. Jesus is addressed. You are the Son of the Most High God. Isn't it interesting that the disciples couldn't even figure out always that Jesus was the Son of the Most High God, the very Savior of the world, at the right hand of the Son of God in every respect. But the devils did. They knew who Jesus was. And so he was addressed, Jesus, Son of the Most High God. Have you come to torment me? There's something else about evil spirits. They know that they're in for a bad time with Jesus. They know that the purpose for Jesus' coming was to work against their work. Fact is, there's a passage in the Bible that says, the Son of Man came to destroy the works of the devil. So the devils know this, but they didn't know how it would be done. So they would only make guesses as to when it would be done. This devil, or these demons collectively, thought, is it now? Jesus then asked a question. What is your name? And the demon-possessed man said, Legion. Because there were many demons within him. A Roman legion, by the way, was a group of 6,000 Roman soldiers. So whether it was that exact number of demons in him, or just by way of comparison, he was loaded full of evil spirits. We get the picture. This guy was totally immersed in absolute, disgusting, frightening evil. And they begged him not to command them to depart into the abyss. They begged Jesus, please don't throw us into the abyss. Now, the abyss, as described in the book of Revelation, and our men's Bible breakfast just completed that, is that bottomless pit, or another word for it is hell. It's the absolute end for all evil forever. And the question, the statement implies, have you come now to throw us into the abyss? Please don't do that. Please don't do that. Notice the demon-possessed man is begging Jesus for reprieve, if only for a while. Here you see who's in charge. And it isn't the demons. And now we come to something that happened which seems hard to understand. I would say unexplainable. I would also say irrational. But I also want to say this. Since when does evil ever appear rational? Have you ever noticed that? When evil happens, when there is evil in the world, it doesn't make sense. It is irrational, as we see right here. A large herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him, the demons in this man begged him to let them enter into these pigs. So Jesus gave them permission for the evil spirits to leave the poor fella and to enter this flock of pigs. The text has it that the demons came out of the man and entered the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and drowned. What a bizarre outcome of Jesus having come face to face with evil. The demons have another day, a reprieve, and it doesn't matter to them whether they occupy the flesh and heart of a real human being or the unclean flesh of Jewish-hated pigs. All the same, they exist. Well, you can imagine the herdsmen. When the pig herdsmen saw what had happened, they took out and ran. We say that in Kansas. They ran. They fled. And they told it in the city and the country. You guys can't believe. The whole herd of pigs was drowned in the waters because of the command of this religious guy that came by. Then the people went out to see what had happened. I imagine what they saw was a bunch of hogs floating in the water. A sad picture of the death of so many, like what we've seen with the cattle down in Kansas, thousands and thousands of them. It's pathetic. It's probably what they saw. They saw that. They came to Jesus and found the man from whom the demons had gone. He was sitting at the feet of Jesus, now no longer naked. I don't think I mentioned that earlier. But now clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid, curiously. I was thinking about that fear that the people had as they saw this man who was now in his right mind. He was clothed. Sanity had been restored. He was no longer possessed by evil. He was no longer a threat to anyone at all. He was calm and collected, as they say. And the people feared that. And I think they feared it because they sensed the presence of the Holy God in what had happened. And whenever the presence of the Holy God is received in the minds of people, they tremble. They're afraid because all people realize that the Holy God and sinful people don't stand side by side. Well, they found the man, and he was restored, and it was hard to understand. Then all the people came by, and they came, and they decided that something great had happened, but they couldn't quite agree that the best thing about what happened was the healing of the demon-possessed man. The best thing that would happen would be for Jesus to get out of their region so that they would no longer have any kind of loss, commercial loss, what they just experienced. In other words, what was more important to them was the money that they lost in the pigs than the poor man receiving sanity. Sometimes that kind of thing and that kind of rationale happens in our society, doesn't it? It's more important that people make money and get ahead regardless of ethics, regardless of what the Bible says, regardless of what God says. I'll do it my way because I want to get ahead. And besides that, who cares? So all the people asked him to depart from them, and they were afraid. So Jesus did what they wanted. He got into the boat, was ready to move on. But this man, that was relieved of the devils, restored in every way to normalcy, wanted to get in the boat with Jesus and the disciples. He thought, this is the best thing that's ever happened to me, and it's all because of Jesus, and I want to go with him wherever he goes. I'm sure that's what he was thinking. But that's not what Jesus was thinking. Jesus sent him away, and he said, return to your home and declare how much God has done for you. I didn't come to this shore by just accident. My purpose was not just to restore you, but I'm thinking about your sons and daughters back in your home that you haven't seen in a long time. Or your wife who's embarrassed of you. I want you to go back to your home. You haven't been there in a long time. They need to see you. They need to see you now. And they need to realize, if they didn't before, that evil that has just overwhelmed you has now been removed from you. You go back and you tell them how that happened. Tell them that there is a God greater than evil. Because in the superstitious world of the first century and in many other areas of world history, evil is considered a great power. Incantations and all kinds of things of various peoples throughout history have tried to solve the problem of evil. Jesus did it with his words. Go back and tell your family, the people in your house, in your home, in your city, that there is a God who's not afraid of evil. And he'll go eyeball to eyeball with it, and he won't back down. And he is stronger than any evil. Now, this message needs to be heard by all of us. We need to remember always, because we live in a world saturated with evil. When it seems like evil has the upper hand, when it seems like this world is just going down, right? Because of evil and evil people, we need to remember, no, from this story, sure, but for our whole understanding of God, that God is creator, redeemer, and sanctifier of all things, and there's no one like him. Our message today on Father's Day is not just for dads, but it is for dads. It's all for all of us. Jesus has a mission for us in our homes, among our children, or grandparents with our grandchildren. Do they know from our lips or from our actions that God is the one that we believe in? And the one that we trust for our salvation? Do they know? Do they really know where our heart is with God? That our God is the God who sent his son Jesus to take on evil, and he won out. Do our kids know that in this world of evil, that finally evil is going to be done away with when Jesus comes back again? All thrown into the abyss, and heaven will reign forever in all of its goodness and purity and love. They need to know, and we need to know as well. So we honor fathers on this Father's Day, not only for all the little things you do, whether it's a baseball mitt, a golf ball, or coaching, or whatever, but also as Christian fathers for the influence that you have for Jesus. And never forget that influence. It's a great influence. I'd just like to close our message today with a wonderful tribute by Chuck Swindoll in his Devotions to Fathers, Man to Man, in his last chapter titled, My Dad and His Death. My dad died last night. He left like he had lived, quietly, graciously, with dignity, without demands or harsh words or even a frown. He surrendered himself. A tired, frail, humble gentleman into the waiting arms of his Savior whom he loved. Then he writes this, as I stroked the hair from his forehead and kissed him goodbye, 100 boyhood memories played around in my head. When I learned to ride a bike, he was there. When I wrestled with the multiplication table, his quick wit erased the hassle. When I discovered the adventure of driving a car, he was near, encouraging me. When I got my first job delivering newspapers,
He informed me how to increase my subscriptions and win the prize. It worked. My guess is maybe he told him, when you throw the newspaper, make sure it lands on the landing, not in the bushes. That's just my guess. I don't know. When I mentioned a young woman I had fallen in love with, he pulled me aside and talked straight about being responsible for her welfare and happiness. And when I did a hitch in the Marine Corps, the discipline I had learned from him made that transition into the military much easier. I was continually amazed at the ability that he had to do things like tie a fragile mantle on the old Coleman lantern. That is tough. Or keep a fire going in the rain. Or to play the harmonica with his hands behind his back. By the way, I saw Rick Zorko in the early service, and I just asked him. He plays harmonica for our church. And I asked Rick, I said, Rick, could you play the harmonica with your hands behind your back? And he said he could. So I guess this is true. I didn't think it'd be possible, but I don't know how that works. Sounds to me like just be a couple of notes and that's it. But anyhow. And keep three strong-willed kids from tearing down the house. Last night, I realized that I had him to thank for my deep love for America, for knowing how tenderly my wife needs to be cared for, and for laughing at impossibilities, which I knew would be really possibilities, and for some of the habits I have picked up, like approaching people with a positive spirit rather than a negative one, staying with a task until it is finished, taking good care of my personal belongings, keeping my shoes shine, speaking up rather than mumbling, respecting authority, and standing alone if necessary in support of my personal convictions rather than giving in to more popular opinions. For these things, I am deeply indebted to the man who raised me. And finally, he says this, in this, my sister, my brother, and I find our greatest comfort. As a Christian, we know that mom and dad are now forever with the Lord, eternally freed from pain and aging and death, secure in Jesus Christ our Lord, absent from the body and at home with him and with each other. When you have a Christian mom or Christian dad, you know that you'll be with them forever. All because there was a guy by the name of Jesus who came, suffered, and died for us, defeated the devil and all evil decisively, and because of that, the gates of heaven are wide open. Let us please rise for prayer. In our prayers this morning, we remember Krista Ehlers and her unborn twins. They need a little more time in the oven. So we pray for that. And Eric Lehman, he's a friend of the congregation who has cancer. Well, we pray for our families and everyone in them, especially on this Father's Day. We thank the Lord for our dads, our grandpas, our great-grandpas, those who have served as male examples of the Christian faith and life. Father, we come thankful for all of them. May their guidance direct us, their witness of Jesus in word and deed inspire us, and their love for us support us throughout our days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who serve and protect us, all those in authority, as we remember the fourth commandment is more than mother and father, but for all people who have responsibilities over us. So we thank the Lord for our police, fire, and emergency personnel who selflessly give of their time and abilities for the welfare of our communities. We thank the Lord for teachers and administrators, for those who are responsible for our welfare every day, for the armed forces of our nation, for those stationed at home and abroad who defend our country in challenging times. May the Lord keep them safe. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those with special concerns and needs this day, like Krista Ehlers with her unborn twins, that they would grow stronger as she waits for delivery, but also for Eric Lehman, who is ill and who needs the Lord's help in healing. We pray for those who mourn and others that we name silently before God who needs his help at this time. Bless them all, gracious Father, that they may find healing and hope and strength of body and soul for the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And finally, Father, we thank you for having placed into our lives faithful Christian people who have guided us. On this day, we remember those who no longer are with us now, who passed on to the joys of heaven, who have been redeemed by the blood of their Savior, Jesus Christ, the same Lord and Savior that we trust today. Lead us to follow in their same way of faith and life, that together we may rejoice in the glories of heaven someday. These and all prayers that we have upon our hearts, we bring to you, confident that you hear the prayers of the people whom you love so much, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we gather tithes and offerings for the work of our Lord.
See you.
Lord's Prayer together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. And also the closing prayer, we give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you strengthen us in the trials of this life and in the assaults of the devil so that we do not lose heart. Guide us this week in all we do, that your name might be glorified through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Everybody have a great Father's Day today. Thank you for coming to worship. Before the benediction, just to announce, we will pick up chairs 7 stack. That'd be great. We'll leave this just as it is. Thank you for that. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. You may be seated.
Blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less. In Jesus' blood and righteousness, I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone. trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne.